Go on. Thank you. I want to welcome you to the 2018 kickoff of the debate series. It's going to be an exciting evening. Tonight we have the Senate District 27 and the Congressional Georgia 7. The time that we'll start is 6:30. We'll run the debates for 1 hour. We'll take a 15-minute recess and then start the congressional debates. A couple of housekeeping things to go over. We'd appreciate if everybody would turn off their cell phones. Secondarily, during the debates, we know that you're all here to support your candidate, but we will not have any booing, hissing, yelling, nothing like that. We want to respect the candidates. Want you to also mark your calendar for May 2nd. That's the Board of Education, Board of Commissioners, and State Court debates. And then May 8th is District 24 State House and District 25 State House. At this time, I'd like to ask Dave Crouch to come please lead us in the pledge and the prayer.
Thank you, Patrick. Good evening. We stand as in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance. To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll just remain standing for just a moment. We'll just have a quick opening prayer. Lord, we just thank you for the privilege to gather here this evening. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being free. We thank you, Lord, for what you have done for this country. And we just ask, Lord, that as we sit here and we listen and we learn from these gentlemen who are running for office, Lord, that you would give each and every one of them wisdom and guidance, and that you will see that this event is conducted in a godly manner. We just thank you, Lord, for being with us right here in this facility at this very minute. And we would just ask you to forgive us where we've fallen short of your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dave. You can be seated. At this time, I want to introduce the debate chairman, Justin Hawkins. He's going to draw who's going to, in what order the candidates are going to answer questions. And while he's doing that, I'm going to read the rules. Just so you'll kind of have a feel for what the candidates are going to be doing. Each candidate is going to be given 2 minutes to introduce themselves. We'll then go into the question phase. The moderator will ask a series of questions. She's not seen them yet, and the candidates have not seen them yet. They'll have 1 minute to answer the question. After that, they will have another opportunity to further clarify their answer or rebut what another candidate may have said. They'll have 1 minute to do that as well. During the final phase of the debate, each candidate will be entitled to ask one other candidate any question of their choice. We've asked them to limit that question to 30 seconds, and then the recipient will have 1 minute to answer. We have a timekeeper stationed right up front, Sarah Hughes. Thank you. She will be keeping time, and her timekeeping is final. What she says is what it is. We're going to ask the candidates to either turn off their phones or give their phones to someone on their staff. We don't want any texting to the candidates or from the candidates. As we've asked all of you, we're going to ask them to conduct themselves with the appropriate decorum. We do support free speech, but crude language and disruptive behavior will not be tolerated. If that's it, I think we're ready to get our questions handed to someone over here. Finally, I want to introduce the moderator. Carolyn Fisher is over here. She's the moderator tonight. Carolyn's a former student. We thought that she would do well. She was a school teacher for 31 years, so we thought she'd be able to handle these guys pretty good. She's a former precinct chair, She's the former second vice chair, the former first vice chair, and the former chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party. She's presently serving as the first vice chair of the Georgia Republican Party. Thank you, Carolyn.
With all of you tonight, I want to let everybody know that I have not seen or had anything to do with the questions that are going to be asked. The only thing that I have done is I called Mr. Bell this afternoon and asked him to please print the questions in a large enough font. I would also like to say that I know each one of these gentlemen and feel as though they are a friend, each of them are, and so I will call them by their first name if that is all right with you, and sometimes I may call them by their first and last name, depending upon how they behave. So we'll begin with Mr. Fielder Bill. Here is the first question. Oh, sorry. All right, Bill, you have 2 minutes to give your opening.
Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank Carolyn and Patrick for being here, and both my opposition as well. So my name is Bill Fielder, and I'm running for State Senate District 27. I'm a third-generation Georgian, a true conservative Georgian, a 20-year Forsyth County resident. I am a pro-Trump conservative Republican, and I'm a small businessman. I grew up in Columbus, Georgia, during the time of the Vietnam War, and I came from a very conservative setting, and I've been conservative since, you can't see my hand, but childhood. In addition to being in that conservative setting, my elementary school teacher, principal in the fifth and sixth grade was Mr. Hancock. Can't recall his first name, never was told it actually, and I've tried to Google it, but can't find it. And he was a direct descendant of John Hancock, so he steeped us in traditional values, conservative values, but respect for the flag and patriotism. I've always been in support of the military and veterans. Natural extension of that, the way my dad brought me up, is to be supportive of law enforcement officers and Second Amendment rights. And I hate the idea of an open border or a sanctuary city. I believe that life begins at conception, and I believe in the right to life. And the thing that got me interested in running for State Senate, even though I've never run for office before or ever been appointed in any capacity in a government seat like my opposition has, was RFRA, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, a straightforward 8-page bill that protects people, places, and organizations from prosecution for refusing to provide service on established religious beliefs. And that is what motivated me to run for State Senate and serve the citizens of Forsyth County. Thank you.
Mr. Tam.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for coming tonight. I want to thank the Forsyth County Republican Party for the opportunity to speak tonight. As parts of our state and nation have continued to struggle, we have focused our attention on positioning ourselves as a great place in which to live, work, raise a family, and retire. Our thriving economy, low tax rate, first-class schools, public safety, and award-winning parks and recreation facilities have made Forsyth County a destination for families and businesses. And it is with this reputation that we are presented with both challenges and opportunities. I believe the Gold Dome could use a little more Forsyth County and our brand of bold, conservative leadership. I have a record of working for you, not special interests. As your senator, I will continue to fight to protect our quality of life, preserve our heritage, promote private sector job creation, ensure every child has access to a quality education, and tackle the opioid epidemic strangling our families and this community. For too long, Forsyth County has been a victim, resulting in our hard-earned tax dollars being sent to other counties and other regions in the state. I will continue fighting to return those dollars home where we as a community know best how to spend them. While serving on the Board of Commissioners, I championed reducing the millage rate on three separate occasions while balancing our county's budget during times of prosperity and throughout the worst recession witnessed by our nation in a generation. I know what it takes to find solutions, navigate complicated government agencies, and deliver results. From the widening of Georgia 400 to securing funding for the Alliance Academy for Innovation, I have a proven and tested record of showing up for work and getting the job done. My name is Brian Tam, and I wish to represent you in the State Senate. I ask for your prayers, your support, and your vote.
Hello, everybody. My name is Greg Dolezal. Carolyn, I want to thank you and the Forsyth County Republican Party for having us, Brian and Bill. Thank you all for being here. I'm not sure if you're just hiding from the pollen storm, if you're interested in politics, but thank you for being here tonight. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a Forsyth County businessman and entrepreneur. I have the opportunity of owning multiple businesses here in Forsyth County and working with organizations all around the world. I've worked with Chris Tomlin and Pastor Louis Giglio as the producer for Worship Night in America and Passion Conferences. I started to engage in Forsyth County politics in 2013 when I started Fix Forsyth Traffic. And from there, I went on to fight President Obama's overreach and radical housing policies for coming here to Forsyth County. But tonight is not about my biography. Tonight is about the future of our community. My favorite member of the community is here tonight, Natalie Dolezal. She is my wife of almost 11 years. She is the mother to my three children who are five and under, and we have our fourth on the way. They are the reason that I'm running for State Senate. You know, I've talked to many of you here in this room tonight, and you say that it's time for bold, conservative leadership. Leaders who stand tall for our values. Leaders who don't crumble in the face of pressure. Leaders who will pull up their sleeves and get to work. I'm going to work to unlock traffic gridlock in Forsyth County. I'm going to work to finally get our kids out of trailers and into classrooms. I'm going to finally eliminate the state income tax right here in Georgia. Can I get an amen? I will keep our community safe by continuing to ban sanctuary cities. I'm going to do all of that, and then I'm going to come home. I'm going to come home because I'm not interested in a career in politics. I am interested in keeping Forsyth County the best place to live, work, and raise a family. My name is Greg Dolezal. I am the conservative that you can count on, and I thank you so much for coming to hear my vision tonight.
And now we'll go to our first question. Thank you, gentlemen. Question? We're going to go to Bill Fielder first. Here's the first question, Bill. Forsyth County seems to be fractured over land use, private property rights, and how to deal with growth. As a state senator, what do you feel will be your role in addressing this?
So when I think about Forsyth County, what I think about is that it's out of balance, that it's out over the tips of its skis, and that there are a lot of moving parts, and that the politicians and the people who claim to have helped in the past have not been much assistance at all. The main function of a state senator, your state senator, will be to bring as much of Forsyth County's money and funds as it can back to Forsyth County from the state capitol. And when it brings it back, to support the infrastructure, to build out the infrastructure to relieve the pressure that you feel now, and not for that money to go to special interests.
Thank you. Brian, do you need for me to read the question again?
If you don't mind.
Forsyth County seems to be fractured over the land, over land use, private property rights, and how to deal with growth. As a state senator, what do you feel will be your role in addressing this?
Thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to say I'd be accessible. I'd be accessible to the public. I'd be in ear to hear their problems, to hear their concerns, and to roll up my sleeves and get involved with the issues. I'd work very hard at the Gold Dome to bring our tax dollars home. We are a donor county. As I said earlier, too often our tax dollars go to other parts of the state. And finally, I would work to unify the county and not divide us. Dividing the county just divides up our resources. It divides up our wealth, and it makes us not able to advance infrastructure and amenities as we otherwise could.
Thank you, Brian. Greg, Would you like me to read the question again?
I think I got it. Thank you, Carolyn.
Okay.
You know, you're right. Forsyth County is fractured today over issues like land use. And what we need are leaders who know how to bring people together. If you look at my website, you'll see a list of a number of community leaders who happen to fall on opposite sides of the land use conversation here in Forsyth County. I've worked to bring those leaders together. As a matter of fact, just this Monday night, I hosted a meeting in my office with people who have various opposing concerns on how we move forward with representation and whether or not Forsyth County needs more municipalities. We had a spirited conversation, and we had an agreement about how to move forward with engaging each other online. That is what I'm going to do as a leader. That is what leaders do. Leaders don't work behind the scenes to build division. Leaders bring people together. And what you learn when you bring people together, what we heard at that table on Monday night, is that Forsyth County is not as divided as some people would have us think. Forsyth County embraces our conservative values. Forsyth County embraces a vision of moving forward with low taxes and a prosperous place to live. And that's what we're going to do, as I'm glad we'll do as a state senator.
Thank you, Greg. We're going to go back now and ask Bill, is there anything that you would like to rebut with either one of your opponents?
There's a lot of talk about bringing Forsyth County together when it shouldn't be fragmented in the first place. There's a lot of talk about bringing funds from the state capital back to Forsyth County, and there's only one candidate that has the sufficient 4-decades-long experience to help accomplish that task, and that is me.
Thank you. Brian?
No, thank you.
Greg?
You know, track records are interesting things, aren't they? You're going to hear each of us tonight tell you about the merits of our track records. I think what you need to do is you need to look not at just what we say tonight, but what has actually been accomplished. I think that the bulk of Forsyth County people want to see more job centers here in Forsyth County, and they want to see us stop rezoning our commercial land to high-density residential. When I served on the Comprehensive Plan Steering Committee, we significantly moved the needle to doing just that, and now we have a board of commissioners who are implementing the plan. Because of what I've done in the past, Forsyth County is going to be a better place, and because of what I will do in the future, Forsyth County will be a better place.
Thank you. Now we're going to go to Brian for question number two. Brian, how do you propose to resolve Georgia's and Forsyth County's traffic congestion issues?
Well, thank you. First of all, I'd like to say I think we took a giant step forward with our partnerships with the Georgia Department of Transportation while I was serving as the chairman of the Transportation Committee. Georgia 400, lanes 5 and 6 are just about complete. It's time to start talking to them about lanes 7 and 8, and it's time to start talking to them about taking the project further north. We need to continue to build partnerships with GDOT. There are a number of roads that are out there. For example, Bellevue Road, GDOT is paying for the construction. However, we partnered up with them. That is not a state highway. Castleberry Road, they gave us $1 million to put towards that road because we got it shovel ready, which means that we already had the right of way, we already had the engineering, made that road ready to go. These are the types of discussions and these are the types of relationships we need to have with GDOT, and I have done that.
No, you know, I think that our traffic woes are no secret to anybody, which when I was a private citizen in 2013, I had done everything right. We were living in Forsyth County. We moved our business to Forsyth County. I had a 7-mile commute that was taking me 45 minutes. A lot of you are living that same nightmare every day. Brian mentioned Castleberry Road. What you do as a state senator, as a county commissioner, whatever you're going to lead, is the exact opposite of what was done on Castleberry Road. Castleberry Road was a $20 million road widening project for a road that had 7,300 cars a day, which is exactly half the amount required to widen the road per our county regulations. Old Atlanta Road, for those of you who live in South Forsyth, got pushed to the back of the line, and it is not finished today because we rushed to get Castleberry Road done. I will look to make sure that we do the right projects, that my decisions are data-driven, not driven by special interests and crony capitalists.
Thank you. bill. Do you want me to read it again?
No, thank you. So this is all intertwined in the fragmentation of Forsyth County, but Old Atlanta is a disaster. Old Atlanta Road is a disaster. That's absolutely right. Castleberry is a road that is built a bit before its time. So again, the politicians, the people who've been involved in addressing this problem in the past haven't gotten it right, and that includes both of the opposition candidates here tonight. I will work with people who I have not yet developed relationships with, because those relationships bind my opposition into delivering obligations on both sides. And you'll get with me an impartial view of how to address and bring back, again, the money that's necessary to support the state projects in Forsyth County. And I'm most interested in Forsyth County, not really the rest of the state of Georgia.
Yes, if you don't mind, how long do I have? Thank you. All right, for those that don't think it was necessary to widen Castleberry Road, they should visit with the families who lost loved ones on Castleberry Road. The role of government is to provide for the health and welfare of its citizens. That road was not just widened because of traffic count, it was relocated. It was relocated so that it had better sight distance, so that it had better geometry, so that it was safer. People were dying on the road. The road was shovel ready, which means the county got it ready by acquiring the right of way and by doing the engineering. That was done ordered several boards before I came into office. The final vote on Castleberry Road was around the $10 or $11 million mark. Again, we needed to widen that road to provide for the safety of our citizens.
Thank you, Brian. I'm having a problem getting the button exactly right. Greg, do you have anything you'd like to piggyback on?
I do, thank you. I want you guys to remember one word tonight when Brian speaks, and that's the word obfuscation. For 12 years, we heard obfuscation. We saw smoke and mirrors. Castleberry Road did not need to be widened. Anybody who has looked into the topic knows that I'm exactly right. As a matter of fact, Commissioner Todd Levent, who was the sitting district commissioner where Castleberry Road lies, presented an alternative plan. County's legal counsel stated that alternative plan would be acceptable. It was a plan to straighten the road, not to widen the road and build a road to nowhere. I just want to add something else that we can do here in Forsyth County. By the way, the Castleberry Road vote, final vote was a 3-2 vote. Brian flipped his vote, and it was a flipped vote to serve his special interests. Something that we can do that's very simple is to open up our arterial roads. We need synced lights here in Forsyth County around the state of Georgia. We need longer turn lanes. We need to see more and more flashing yellows. That's low-hanging fruit, and that's things that we can do that will move the needle to get our traffic moving.
Thank you. Bill,
do not have anything to add. Thank you.
Sorry about the buttons. We're going to go to Greg now, and we're going to piggyback on that question, and we're going to ask you with a follow-up, what is the best way to fund and construct state transportation projects as well as county projects? And I ask you to remember that I did say the word state, not just county.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. You know, in 2015, the Georgia delegation passed the largest tax increase in the history of the state of Georgia. It was HB 170. And what it did was it moved us from a sales tax on gasoline to an excise tax on gasoline. And GDOT's budget more than doubled overnight. In addition to that, the Georgia budget has increased approximately 50% over the last 8 years. Unlocking traffic gridlock is a core competency of government, isn't it? That's something that we know that government should do. So since we have GDOT's money, the budget doubled overnight, since state funds have increased over 50% in the last 8 years, we have more than enough money to fund state roads without taking more money out of the pockets of Georgians.
Bill?
Can you read the question again, please?
Yes, I will. We're going to follow up on the first, on the question before, by asking what is the best way to fund and construct, and remember, this is also state. I'm asking about state transportation as well as county projects.
Thank you. Well, I disagree with Greg. Government doesn't have a core competency other than raising taxes. And I also disagree with Greg. The state budget is up 66% in the last 7 years, from $15 billion to $25 billion. Actually, now it's $26 billion in this next fiscal year. Government doesn't have, and the state of Georgia doesn't have much or any financial discipline, and it doesn't have much or any accountability. And so the first thing that needs to be done to fund really everything that the state needs to fund is to introduce accountability and discipline. And you will find that within the state budget, the needs of the citizens of Forsyth County and the state of Georgia can be met with the existing budgets. Thank you.
Brian.
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like for me to read the question?
No, ma'am.
Do you? You've got it.
So this is the situation. There are 159 counties in Georgia, and there are 159 counties at the Gold Dome at the Georgia Department of Transportation asking for funding. That doesn't include the municipalities. So the funding is scarce. The best way to do this is through planned partnerships. There are planned partnerships going on right now in Forsyth County. Although these projects are lagging behind, mostly due to the recession and our inability to bring funding back to our county, as I mentioned before, Bethelview Road, Castleberry Road, Georgia 400, and yes, even Highway 20 have both county and state funds involved in them. You have to go down there with a plan, with a reason, a way to solve the problem. You just can't go down there and drop it in their lap and expect them to run back up here with funding. I will also speak to Greg's House Bill 170. House Bill 170, the problem with 170 is, I'll wait till rebuttal. Thank you.
All right, Greg, do you have anything
about the budget? I do not.
I would just like to mention that planned partnerships are another form of taxation, the government's core competency. And what I don't want to see is for that form of taxation to be used to feed the special interests in this county.
Brian.
Yes, my rebuttal. Greg's comment about House Bill 170, here's the problem. The problem with House Bill 170 is you have a seven-member state delegation, and four of them voted for it, and three of them voted against it. And the bottom line is there were no major projects to speak of that came to Forsyth County. The way to do that is to build a consensus and say, hey, Governor, we have seven votes, and here is our list of projects that we want for Forsyth County. If you remember House Bill 170, which you probably don't, because there really weren't any town hall meetings about it or any open forum to discuss it, or people to go on the record and tell you how they were going to vote for it. We lost out.
Okay, we're going to go to the next question. And the person who is up is Bill. Bill, do you support the creation of a new city in South Forsyth County, and tell us why or why not?
So what I believe is that all Forsyth Countyans, Forsythians, have the right to choose their own form of government. And I would not be a person who would want to be in the way of people in Forsyth County choosing their own form of government, whether it's in South Forsyth or whether in North Forsyth. On a personal note, what I'll add to that is that rarely is more government a good answer. And my fear is that there will be a build out of additional costs that are uncontrollable For instance, in just one instance, there's a salary proposed for a mayor of $15,000 a year. There's been no discussion about the cost of the city manager or the cost of staff or all of the other costs. And so on a personal note, I think it's an extremely risky proposition.
Thank you, Brian.
Yes, thank you very much. As I stated in part at the town hall meeting a few weeks ago, another layer of government is not the answer. It solves nothing. It's a decentralization of services. It divides up our resources. I am not in favor. I'm a no. For those of you who are opposed to it, I want you to know I am with you, I am opposed to it. To those of you that are for it, I want to be your ear and try to work with you and hear your concerns. But this is not the answer. This solves nothing.
All right, I'm going to go to Greg.
I'm not in favor of a new city at this time in Forsyth County. I'm not in favor of a new city in the foreseeable future as far as my eye can see in Forsyth County. The reason for that is I do not believe we have exhausted all options for better representation. I think it's important that we back up and talk about why this is even a conversation. I find it interesting that Brian is now willing to be an ear. But the reality is that for 12 years, Brian's ear was in the mouths of the special interests, if you will. He's owned 11,000 high-density attached housing units here in Forsyth County in 12 years. People are looking for better representation. I think that there's better representation that we can do by changing the county charter. I think that we can move to a hybrid model for our Board of Commissioners. I think that we can have the option for a supermajority required to overrule a district commissioner in their own commission district, because right now,
okay, Bill, do you have anything that you would like to rebut?
Thank you.
Brian?
No, thank you.
Greg?
Thank you, I was kind of seamless there. Right now, you have the ability to vote for one county commissioner, one. Three of them can make decisions for something in your backyard and you cannot touch them at the ballot box. That is not representative government. I believe that many of you have been disenfranchised by that model. Before we do anything new relative to new municipalities, I want to see us fix the model and put in place the most representative model that we can. Zoning decisions should be pushed locally down to the local level. When I was on the Planning Commission, I was charged with making decisions for areas that were 30, 40 minutes away from me. Quite frankly, I wasn't the best person to do that. There are multiple things that we can do to bring better government to Forsyth County. I was calling for that for a couple of years, wrote a letter to my commissioners years ago, and unfortunately, nothing was done.
As a point of order, may I get my minute now? Thank you.
All right, we're gonna go to another question, and that question is, you know that you all, while you will
be... It's me, Carolyn.
Pardon?
Is this for me or is this...
This is going to be for Brian.
Thank you.
At first. That you all, while coming from being a part of the Forsyth delegation, you do represent the people of the state of Georgia. In what ways do you propose that education in the state can be improved? And that goes to Brian first.
Thank you. Well, first of all, the more we can keep it local, with local control, and allow our local school system to make decisions locally, the better off we're going to be. We have the best school system in the state of Georgia. We have highest graduation rate, highest test scores, the list goes on and on and on. And this is done by local control. Our community is very involved in our school system. I'm proud that my family is as well. This is what it takes to build a quality school system. The school system is the benchmark for which a community is measured. And the more we keep it local, the better off we are.
Great.
I agree with Brian, we need to keep control local for our schools. We need to do everything that we can to encourage President Trump and Secretary DeVos to get rid of Common Core. We need Georgia-grown standards here in Georgia. We need to do everything that we can do to get our kids here in Forsyth County out of crowded schools. For the children who are not fortunate enough to be in Forsyth County, we need to provide an escape hatch for them out of their failing schools. We need to put we need to put parents in charge of the education of their children, and we need to give choices and options for education. I would support tax credits or vouchers. I've been endorsed by House Rep Wes Cantrell, who through another school choice bill this year, and I look forward to working with people like Wes moving forward to provide choices and options in education and unleash free market principles to get the best education in the hands of our students.
Bill.
Thank you, Carolyn. The closer to home that education occurs, the better off the community. And that is true for all of the state, all of the counties in the state. And it is extremely difficult to be able to pass along your core values as a community to your children unless you can bring those issues and that control of your school, your board of education, as close to home as possible. I support school choice. I support homeschooling. I had the wonderful opportunity of judging some homeschoolers in a debate on Saturday. And you know, the future of America is not lost. These were wonderful young people who were smart, who were respectful, who knew how to conduct themselves well in society. And they really amazed me. I do support vouchers. And I oppose Common Core and have from the beginning.
Thank you, Bill. Brian, do you have anything you'd like to rebut?
I do. One of the things I'm most proud of while serving on the Board of Commissioners is that I was able to initiate the funding for the Alliance Academy. Many of you probably haven't heard of it, but you know what? It's got 600 kids it's going to open up with this year, and it's already full. That's right. 600 kids are going there, and they haven't even seen it. This is a school, there's one of three in the state. And at this school, it is funded a large portion of through local dollars, the Public Facilities Authority. It has no gymnasium, it has no football field, it has no performing arts center. It is for kids who want to follow career paths, and there's a demand for that. That school was built in half the time for half the money. And that is something that we really need to, that this community has embraced.
Great.
Again, I just want to say that I support student-centric models to education. Let me give you guys a couple of bullet points of things that I think that we can do that will move the needle, some very specific things. Right now, our state school board is not elected. It's appointed. I want to see all of our state school board members elected so they are accountable to each and every one of you in the state of Georgia. I want to see charter schools funded at the average level. Right now it's at a low level. We need to fund charter schools. And again, the principle here is that we don't necessarily need the help in Forsyth County. But when we have failing schools in Georgia, they drag down our state numbers. And when the state numbers are drugged down, it casts a shadow over all of the schools in Georgia. Education is a core competency of government. We have a constitutional requirement in the state of Georgia to provide a QBE, which is a quality basic education. The state this year has finally fully funded that. That is good news for us, and I'm going to make sure that we continue to do that in the future as well.
Thank you. Bill?
I'll just add that we need to support our teachers, our new teachers across the state, so that when they begin what they decided to make as their career, they end up not getting washed out or burned out in 3 years. We need to develop programs that identify those teachers that may be at risk and provide the support for them so that they enjoy their job, love their job, and support children the best.
Thank you. All right, we're gonna go to Greg now. And this is a good one. What is your position regarding the legalization of cannabis products for medical purposes, and what is your position for recreational purposes?
That's a good question. Thank you, Carolyn. Georgia actually has some of the loosest cannabis laws regarding medical cannabis in the Southeast. We currently have 14 allowed diagnoses that will allow you to be prescribed medical cannabis. I am supportive of that. I have often told my wife, if we have had the conversation, if our child suffered from one of those diseases, that I would do what I needed to do. And I think that is something that we need to empower parents to be able to do for their children. On the recreational side, I'm not supportive of medical cannabis in Georgia. I'm sorry. On the recreational side, I'm not supportive of recreational cannabis in Georgia. Thanks.
Thank you. Bill?
Thank you, Carolyn. So let me just start with, I am not in support of recreational marijuana use in the state of Georgia. So let me talk about medical marijuana use for a moment. I believe this is one way to help address the opioid epidemic that we are experiencing by using medical marijuana to help people who are in pain and people who are suffering from things like the side effects of chemotherapy. So this includes people of all ages, children and adults. And there are children who suffer seizures, multiple hundreds of seizures a day, and medical marijuana absolutely addresses those issues. So where there's proven efficacy, I'm in full support of the use of medical marijuana. Thank you.
Brian.
I don't know how to say what they said differently, but I do not support recreational marijuana at all. I do support medical marijuana for cannabis oil for doctor close supervision.
All right, let's see. Greg, do you have anything that you...
I do. I'd just like to add, my friend David Clark, who's in the House, introduced a measure this year to add a 15th diagnosis, and that's PTSD. My brother was in the Air Force, fought in Iraq and Afghanistan, served in Diego Garcia. While he was there, he was injured, had a head injury. Took him a while to figure out what was going on. Eventually, he got a medical discharge. He was having absent seizures. He came home and he suffered tremendously from PTSD. He was in and out of VA rehab 3 separate times for alcoholism. It was a strain on our family. And I would like to offer options to people like my brother, veterans like my brother, who come home and need medical care. All in all of the above approach, it's the least that we can do for them.
Thank you. Bill, anything?
No, thank you. I don't have anything.
Brian? Yet.
Thank you.
No,
ma'am.
Okay, we're going to go to Bill now. And this is the question that I want to ask. What should the state of Georgia do to reduce the costs of health care?
Well, to me, the first and most obvious answer is to get rid of Obamacare. Of course, the state of Georgia can't get rid of Obamacare. That badly needs to happen. And I've been in support of Trump from day one since Trump announced his candidacy. And that is the first step to getting ready to make healthcare more efficient and less costly. I do believe that Georgia can take some steps, and those steps are to make the market as competitive as possible so that providers and capitalism can take control of the market. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian.
Well, first of all, Obamacare, the rules that have come in with that clearly aren't working. There needs to be a more competitive environment which local, or not necessarily local, but private firms can get in the marketplace and start providing care and offering it at a reasonable price, and they would compete with one another.
Thank you, Brian. Greg?
Thank you. My business partners are here tonight, and every year for the last 5 years, we have faced double-digit increase for us to provide health care to our employees. As a small business owner, something I've dealt with here in the state of Georgia, and I have a specific plan. There's a number of things that we can do, among which are to create high-risk pools, to put people with pre-existing conditions into a high-risk pool. 34 other states have high-risk pools. Georgia needs to become number 35. This will drive down costs. We need to repeal certificates of need. Certificates of need cost 4 percent for an insured person, 7% to provide for Medicaid. Finally, we need to begin to use technology and data analytics for state employees, similar to what Tennessee and North Carolina are doing. I said finally, I'll give one more finally. We need to level the playing field between individual purchased insurance and employer purchased insurance, and remove the taxation from individual placed, purchased insurance.
Thank you, Greg. We're going to go. Bill, do you have anything that you'd like to?
I do. I would just submit to you that high-risk pools, part of Greg's answer, really just take the cost off of business and put it onto the state. It actually puts it on the back of the citizenry of the state. I don't see that as something that really addresses the overall cost of health care. I would also say that, again, Obamacare must go because it has other limitations on business, and it is a it shackles business with tremendous burdens and regulations. And across the board in Georgia, we should remove regulations in every place possible, including health care.
Thank you. Brian?
No, thank you.
Greg?
I agree with my two opponents that we need to repeal Obamacare. I was heavily disappointed when I saw John McCain cast the deciding vote in dramatic fashion. To me, that was example A of why we need term limits. I'm the only candidate in this race who has signed a term limit pledge and applied a term limit to myself. I do want to address this Trump thing, though. I received the mailer from Bill saying that he's the only pro-Trump candidate in the race and that he's been pro-Trump from the beginning. I like Bill. He's a sharp guy. He's a nice guy. Bill did not vote in the 2016 Republican primary. He could not have been pro-Trump from the beginning. If that was an outlier, I would think that that would be okay. Bill did not vote in 2012 when we were trying to remove Barack Obama from office. That was after Obamacare. That was after Putin needing flexibility. That was after the $787 billion stimulus package. Bill has voted in one Republican primary in the last 25 years.
Okay, we're going to go to Brian now. Brian, what will you do to prevent illegal immigration in Georgia?
Everything possible. My businesses participate in E-Verify. We are very thorough and make sure that when we hire somebody, they have the proper documentation. We run it through the system. We do everything we can. You know, this is a problem for us as a community, because you have an economy that people are not paying their taxes on, that people are getting paid in cash, that people are standing on the side of the road and getting picked up and put to work without being on the payroll. So I am all about stopping illegal immigration.
Greg.
I want to start with a principle. And that principle is that legal immigration enriches our culture, and illegal immigration impoverishes our culture. So that's the high-level principle, right? I'm going to continue to make sure that we ban sanctuary cities here in Georgia. And to the extent that Decatur or Emory want to become sanctuary cities, I'm going to work to defund them of every penny possible of state funding. Secondly, I'm going to work with Sheriff Ron Freeman, who is here tonight and has endorsed my campaign, to implement a 287G program. That's a program that will deputize his agents to enforce immigration laws after arrest and after due process. We cannot only rely on ICE, we have a fantastic sheriff's department here, and we need to allow them to help us solve the criminal illegal immigration problem in Georgia.
Bill.
Thank you, Carolyn. I do agree with Greg. We absolutely do need to implement the 287 illegal immigration deportation program. This law allows local enforcement to work with ICE and to get across the state and to deport illegal aliens. Legal immigration, when done well, is the kind of thing that you see when you see my mother, who is the product of two people who met at an orphanage, one Spanish immigrant and one is a Swedish immigrant, and works because the family came together when my parents met at USO Dance in the 50s when my dad was in the Air Force. Sanctuary cities need to be defunded. The border needs to be controlled. And illegal immigration needs to be completely stopped.
Nothing.
I agree with everything Bill said. A couple other things that we can do to help us with illegal immigration. Right now, E-Verify is only required on small businesses with 10 employees or more. I would like to see universal E-Verify in Georgia. It's something that we do in all of our businesses. It's not a significant burden. It's something that small businesses can do as well. Something else I would like to see happen, I will have no control over this, but I will lobby my elected officials, and that is to bring our troops home from Iraq and Afghanistan. We've been at war for 17 years, and we have never declared war. We need to bring our troops home, get them off of foreign soil, and we need to allow them to help us protect and defend our border. My campaign manager is here tonight. His name's Alf Chaul. He's a first-generation immigrant from Brazil. Like Bill's mother, he did immigration the right way. When immigration is done right, it enriches our culture. We need to allow people who have done the right thing to pursue the American dream.
Bill.
No, thank
you. All right, we're going to go to the next question. And this will be our final question, gentlemen. And then you will have your wrap-up statement. Oh, that's right. Quickly, what are your top legislative priorities in the General Assembly next year? Great.
That's for me. Fantastic. I'm excited to be coming in 2019. We're going to have a new governor, a new lieutenant governor, and a new legislature. So we're going to have the opportunity to finally move the needle on the conservative agenda. I want to eliminate the state income tax in Georgia and put more money into each and every one of your pockets. I want to do what we just talked about, and that is continue to ban sanctuary cities. All of our Republican gubernatorial candidates have gotten behind religious freedom. I've been endorsed by Sam Teasley, who is the author of the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in the Georgia House. And I want to work with Sam and my fellow legislators to get RFRA to the governor's desk for the second time and then ensure that the governor signs it.
Bill.
Yeah, it's interesting that Greg talks about RFRA. Greg has taken money, lobbyist money, from McGuire Woods, and has gotten in bed with the lobbyist firm that led the fight to defeat RFRA in the past. Greg is talking about all of the people who support him and represent the establishment who haven't accomplished anything in the last 12 years in the state government. And I think that Greg, who has talked about his endorsement tonight from Ron Freeman, and I know Ron Freeman, he's a wholesome man, he's a God-fearing man, and he is a warrior for this county. And I'm curious as to whether he knew that Greg would get in bed with the people who opposed RFRA when Greg sought his endorsement. And Greg, I would ask you to get out of bed with those folks, to recant your alliance with the people who lead RFRA, and send the money back.
Brian.
Top things I want to do as your next state senator revolve mainly around funding, because that's something that affects us all immediately. First of all, transportation. This county worked hard to get 400 lanes 5 and 6 near completion. It's time to start working on lanes 7 and 8. It's time to start negotiating moving that project further north. You know, the county entered into a transportation bond and it's only acquired half the funding so far. It doesn't have to borrow more money with the right relationships downtown. Some of these relationships that we have resulted in, and I'm very proud to say, $350 million in commitments from the Georgia Department of Transportation for Highway 9, plans for Post Road, for McGinnis Ferry Road, and for the interchange at McGinnis Ferry and Georgia 400. Secondly, school funding. You know what we have going?
All right, Greg, do you have anything you want to rebut?
I'm not going to rebut. I'm going to add to my legislative agenda because I actually have one. I want to ensure that we fully fund our schools here in Forsyth County. About half of our students sit in overcrowded schools today, and we have a problem getting our money for the state. There's a number of things that we can do to make sure that we get our money back here and that we get our kids out of trailers and into classrooms. Another thing that I want to do, I want to put a constitutional cap on state spending. You mentioned the numbers before, my round number of 50-something percent, bill offer number 60-something percent. The reality is, the exact number, I should say, this is going to shock you as soon as I find it here, the state budget has increased from $17.5 billion in 2011 to $26.2 billion in 2019. We need to cap state spending and begin to starve the beast of government.
Bill. RFRA is what motivated me, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. Just like in local education, you cannot pass along your culture, your beliefs, and your system, and your outlook on life to your children without local education. You cannot do that without RFRA. When you have to be worried about how you tell your children they should be raised and how they should act and comport themselves, when your hands are tied and you have to worry about losing everything you've ever accomplished in your life because your RFRA law doesn't exist, it really does infuriate me. So that is a motivation and a legislative agenda. Illegal immigration, it is what it is, and it's straightforward, and we need to be stronger about it. Both my opponents are part of the establishment and special interests. I am not, and I can accomplish these things, these legislative agendas, without owing anything. Greg has over 200 endorsements. By the time he's returned favors to all those endorsements, he won't have any time to accomplish the legislative agenda.
Brian.
Thank you. I'm just going to continue on with funding back to our county. First of all, school funding. I'm a big proponent. I support school impact fees. While on the Board of Commissioners, I initiated a revision to our impact fee policies. We need more funding for our schools. We need money for safety for our schools. We need to partner up with the state to make sure that we can build more things like the Alliance Academy and get funding for those. And then I'm a big fan of accountability courts. Accountability courts such as drug court, the mental health court, these sorts of things that went into play when I came into office, keep people out of the prison system and rehabilitate them so they don't go down the same road they just came from.
All right, we have come to the part of our debate where each candidate may ask one other candidate a question on any topic. You have 30 seconds to ask your question, and the person who you ask the question has 1 minute to respond. And we're going to start with Greg. You may ask a question.
Thank you, Carolyn. My question tonight's for Brian. Brian, you know I like your restaurants. I told you the creme brulee is probably the best in town. It's really good, folks. In the spirit of a good restaurant, Brian, I'd like to offer you a menu tonight. And your choices are as follows. Your 2008 millage rate increase. Your 2009 millage rate increase. Your failed proposal in 2010 to raise the millage rate 40%. Your energy excise tax, your cell phone tax. Brian, of all of your tax increases, which one is your favorite?
Well, thank you, Greg. I'll go ahead and straighten it out. You said 2008 millage rate, I was a no. 2009, I was a no. 2010, I brought forward the recommendation of staff to this room, and after hearing the comments from the public, when the vote came forward to raise the millage rate in 2010, I voted against it. So, I'm an ice cream guy, I guess.
Brian.
Yes.
You may ask a question.
Oh, okay. My question's for Greg. While I was in office for about 5 years with smoking ears and ignoring my constituents, the park and recreation bond was already approved and something interesting happened. You moved here. Other than your lovely wife having family here, why did you choose to move to Forsyth County after I've been in office roughly 5 years?
Brian, I don't know who does your opposition research. I moved here in 2006, so you might need to fire your opposition research guy. I moved here because I fell in love with my beautiful wife. She's a graduate of Forsyth Central High School, and she is everything that is right about this community. And as a point of order, and we have a, we can put this on our website later tonight, when Brian left office, the millage rate in Forsyth County was 30% higher than when he entered office. Forsyth County's population grew 69% while Brian was in office, but county spending grew 139%. County bonds increased 183%. The county millage rate, as I mentioned, increased. The county property taxes collected increased 147%. The county bonds, not including schools and county revenue, increased 519%. So Brian, I love this community. Regretfully, the tax bill is higher than it needs to be. But to answer your question, I moved here because I fell in love with Natalie Pritchett.
A little has been said about my pro-Trump stance and the fact that I came out for Trump first thing after he announced. I came out for Trump in a huge way on social media, in a big way. So much so that it caught the attention of some local leaders who in fact asked me to run for state senate. And I looked at RFRA and I decided between that question and RFRA, the answer was yes.
All right.
I didn't get to ask my question, sorry.
Is that it?
Well, she said stop, so.
Okay, we're fine, okay now. All right, so here is the next part. We're going to, each one of you will have 1.5 minutes to make a closing statement. Now, he had 30 seconds. Each one of you will have 1.5 minutes to make a closing statement. And we're going to begin with Greg.
Thank you, Carolyn. Let me close by saying thank you to the Forsyth County Republican Party for hosting this debate, for all of you for being here tonight. It's really, really impressive. I want to thank Brian and Bill for participating. And I know that by working with the men and women in this room, by the way, about half of which have endorsed me, you are my special interest, by the way, we can create a state and county that is stronger than ever before. What you've heard tonight is a stark difference in how we're going to do that. We can turn to a career politician who saddled us with higher taxes, crippling debt, gridlocked roads, and overcrowded schools. Or we can opt for a businessman who's been absent in our quest for the conservative cause. Someone who's voted for Republican one time in a primary in the last 25 years. It didn't help us get Barack Obama out of office. I'm running because I believe you deserve a better option. I'm gonna work to find high-tech, high-paying jobs for our families and children because as a businessman in Forsyth County, I've done it. I'm gonna continue to lead the fight to allow families to spend more time together and less time in traffic. As an active member of our community, I've done it. I'm gonna work to keep your taxes low and make sure developers pay their fair share. As an effective leader, I've done it. I'm gonna protect our values from liberal overreach because as a concerned citizen, I've done it. I'm a business owner, I'm a devoted father, I'm a husband, and I'm the conservative that you can count on to get the job done. I would ask for your vote on May 22nd.
Thank you very much, Greg. Bill?
Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I just want to say, once again, what excited me about doing this was RFRA. I am going to fight for the citizens of Forsyth County. What you have in front of you is a business person who has worked for 4 decades and already brought thousands of jobs through the acquisition, public offering, and help of 3 technology companies in Forsyth County. It happened before Greg got here, so I guess he doesn't know about it. I also will work for each of you to keep the special interests from getting their hands on money that is meant to come back here and support Forsyth County citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Brian?
Thank you. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity tonight. Thank you for coming out, folks. Thank you, Greg and Bill. There's a saying, if it walks like a duck, talks like a duck, chances are it's a duck. If you're funded and supported and endorsed by the special interest of the Sharon Springs Group, you are Sharon Springs. If you want someone who is going to add a new layer of government and seven new politicians to Forsyth County, I am not your guy. But if you want someone who will unify and represent all of Forsyth County, I am your guy. If you want someone who is tested and ready to go to work on day one, I am your guy. If you want someone who has proven results, widening Georgia 400, partnering and backing law enforcement, helping businesses succeed, and fighting to return tax dollars to Forsyth County, I am your guy. I have shown I can protect our values, and now more than ever, it's time for Gold Dome to have a little more Forsyth County under it. For those of you opposed to the city of Sharon Springs, I am your voice. To those of you who support it, I want to be your ear. I have worked before to unite this county on many issues over the years. Parks and recreation, transportation, public safety. We've shown we can be united. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank the Forsyth County Republican Party for asking me to moderate this debate tonight. I want to thank each and every one of you for following the rules. And I want to thank each of the gentlemen who came out tonight and worked hard to be able to answer the questions that they did not know anything about before they came. And I also want to thank you for behaving like such gentlemen. Thank you very, very much.
We'll take about a 10-minute break, and then we'll get started with the congressional debate. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Series. The next debate is the congressional debate for Georgia District 7, Rob Woodall and Shane Hazel. To this debate, would somebody close those doors? Justin, close those doors. Justin, you got it? Thank you. This portion of the debate will be moderated by Julian Thompson. Julian's come over from Gwinnett County to assist us this evening. She's a former legislative aide in the U.S. House of Representatives and a former communications director for the Georgia Republican Party. She's a political contributor for BBC World News. She's a regular panelist on the Georgia Public Broadcasting's Political Rewind. She served as a surrogate for President Donald Trump during the 2016 general election and is a state and executive committee member of the Georgia Republican Party. Julian is married to Jason Thompson. They have two children, and they come over and visit us from Sewanee. Julian, thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Justin will determine the order in which the questions will be asked. Congressman Woodall will take the first question.
Good evening. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to go over a few basic rules before we start this debate. I'm sure that none of these general housekeeping rules would apply to either one of these candidates, but I'm going to say them anyway. No sending or receiving any text messages during the debate. Each candidate will conduct themselves in a diplomatic manner. Disruptive behavior and crude language is not acceptable, which we know is not going to happen, but we're going to say it anyway. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to introduce himself and discuss the issues that are important to his campaign. There will be a general question session for the first part, where each candidate will be asked the same question in alternating order. The answers will be 1 minute. If applicable, a rebuttal of 30 seconds will be allowed. We have a lot of material to cover tonight, so rebuttals will be at my discretion. Specific candidate questions will follow the general questions, and each candidate will be allowed to ask the other candidate a question of their choice. Following that, there will be a 1.5 minute closing from each candidate. And with that, we will get started. And who drew the first question? Okay. Congressman Woodall. Recent public shootings have opened back up the debate on gun control. What measures from the federal government, if any, do you support to improve school safety, and how do you balance this with protecting Second Amendment rights?
Excuse me, hold on just a minute, Congressman. They need to make their own statement.
Oh, I am so sorry. That is my fault. So each candidate will get an opening statement. Thank you. 2 minutes.
Well, thank you, Julianne. I thank you for agreeing to moderate, and thank you to Jason for hosting the event. Patrick, congratulations to you on your new role. I'm excited to have you there for the next 9 months. We have an amazing amount that we can do together, you and I. And my message to you tonight is: as we sit here right now, you and I have never been more powerful as United States citizens. We've never had more influence on that process that goes on in Washington than we do right now. And I would tell you that's good news, because this has been a community of problem solvers. It's less important for us to figure out who to blame for it, and more important for us to figure out how we can play a role in fixing it. That has been the reputation I have tried to develop in Congress with your voting card since you first lent it to me in 2011. I'm incredibly proud of what we have done together. And it will come as no surprise to you to know that the last 12 or 13 months have been much easier to get things done than those previous 6 years. The entire success of conservative politics, the entire success of the Republican Party hinges on us being able to look each other in the eye and say we're making a difference today that's going to make tomorrow better than yesterday was. That's the standard I use when I wake up every day with your voting card on Capitol Hill. Did we make a difference together today? I hope you can feel the difference that we're making together. I hope your family feels the difference that we're making together. And I am incredibly pleased to be here with you tonight and talk to you about where we have come from and where we can still go together. Thank you very much, Julianne.
Thank you, Congressman Will. Mr. Hazel.
Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Shane Hazel. I'm running for U.S. Congress here in the Georgia 7th, obviously. I grew up here, and I'd like to thank you all for coming out to be a part of this process. Thank you to the Forsyth County GOP. Rob, thank you for coming out tonight and being part of this. Thank you guys is not enough, because it's the Georgia 7th is my home. I have lived here almost my entire life. I went to Brookwood High School, graduated in 1998. Shortly after 9/11, I joined the United States Marine Corps, where I was fortunate enough to do two deployments with 1st Force Reconnaissance Company, fought through the battles of Najaf and Fallujah, a lot of things that I saw that I don't want anybody to ever see here in America. When I got done, I moved back here to Forsyth County. I graduated from UGA in International Affairs, and this is where I met my beautiful wife, Meredith, and we had our three children, and we started a family here. Why am I running for U.S. Congress? Because for the last 8 years, we have been told, give us a House, give us a Senate, and give us a presidency. And what have we done? Because it's not all good news. I am sick to death of career politicians who don't hold town hall meetings in person. I am sick to death of the fact that we are still funding things like gun control, Planned Parenthood to the tune of $500 million. I am sick to death of sanctuary cities, domestic spying. I am sick to death that we are still funding Obamacare. I am sick to death that they are taking the lives of my brothers and sisters in service and as veterans flippantly. And I am sick to death for the 21 trillion other reasons that they have compromised my children's future. I look forward to earning your vote May 22nd and fighting the establishment in D.C. because with you, we can bring the Constitution back and we can restore this republic. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel. I'll go back to the first question that I asked before. Recent public shootings have opened back up the debate on gun control. What measures from the federal government, if any, do you support to improve school safety, and how do you balance this with protecting Second Amendment rights? Congressman Woodall.
Julian, I think your question hits at exactly what the problem is that we're having addressing this issue in a way that brings folks together. Some folks describe this as a gun control issue. Some folks describe this as a school safety issue. I would tell you it is only a school safety issue. This is not a problem of old gray-haired men like me walking into our schools. This is a problem of young people hurting young people. What's happening culturally that's true? Now, what have we done at the federal government level? We focused on the database that's supposed to prevent bad actors from getting guns. Had that worked properly, we wouldn't have had Parkland play out the way Parkland had worked, nor Texas play out the way Texas played out. And we funded the COPS grant program, which for those communities that have been caught behind the eight ball, Forsyth has not, Gwinnett has not, but provides those dollars that folks need immediately to be able to make those changes that then those localities and counties will pay for long term.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Yeah, laws don't stop crimes. Men with guns stop crimes. You can take it from a guy who's voted for Fix Nixon in H.R. 38, which puts veterans to the tune of 35,000 veterans a year, or 200 since 2010, 200,000 veterans on lists without due process. That is just not what we do here in America. You have an inalienable, God-given right to own a firearm, period. And what we need to do is arm our schools. They are soft targets, they are target-rich environments. Now, when I talk about H.R. 4660, Mr. Woodall voted for it. That was the Obama anti-gun agenda that put veterans and senior citizens that received Social Security on lists without due process as well. What we need to do is reinstate the Constitution and get the federal government out of it. Shall not be infringed means shall not be infringed in any way, shape, or form. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall, your name was invoked.
Thank you, Julianne. I didn't know the bill by bill number, but by context, I think the bill that he's talking about is the bill that the NRA supported to make the NICS, the Violent Crime Database, work the way it's supposed to work. If you don't want a background check for gun purchases, repeal the law that requires a background check for gun purchases. But if we're going to have a background check, it ought to work properly. That's what this money did. That's why the NRA supported it. That's why lifetime NRA members voted yes. That's why I supported it as well. It's not enough to pay platitudes to the real fears that families have. And dadgummit, it's my fault as your federal congressman. If I have a federal plan that's not working properly, I need to repeal it or make it do what I promised you it would do. I chose the latter, and I'm proud of it.
Thank you. The next question, we will start with Mr. Hazel. State legislators and Governor Deal have expressed reservations about President Trump's plan to allow offshore drilling off of the Georgia coast. Do you support offshore drilling off of our coast? And if so, how do we ensure protection for wildlife and our coastal waters and beaches?
Well, it definitely isn't the, sorry about that. Well, it definitely isn't the department that handles our environmental issues at the federal level. Obviously, a couple years ago, we saw them dump tons of raw sewage into the Colorado River. What we need to do is control our own state and get the federal government out of it. We need more control here at home, less government regulation, because as we know, through this omnibus bill that spends billions of dollars inside of the environment here in Georgia, it puts regulations that we as Georgians don't necessarily agree with. Do we need to drill for energy? Absolutely. Is it something that we need to protect the environment? Yeah. As a hunter, I'm a conservationist. What we need to do is take control of our own land per Article 1, Section 8, Clause 17, I believe. The only federal control of our state they should have is forts, ports, and magazines at our discretion. And so I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. Congressman Woodall.
Well, we're talking about offshore waters here, and I suspect if I look around the room, I'll find folks who've been supporting offshore drilling around the United States of America for decades. President Obama was working hard to prevent America from harvesting its energy resources, and we have consistently said all of the above. Let's do it all. Now, my job is to make sure the federal government's not standing in our way to run this state the way we see fit. I understand why Governor Deal would have those concerns. Julianne, in fact, every governor of coastal states does have that concern, but it strikes me as a bit hypocritical to continue to vote year after year to open up the Gulf Coast along Florida's, Alabama, and Mississippi shores, and now to say, oh no, but those Georgia waters are off limits because our shore is special. Our shore is special. And my commitment to you is, we're not going to do anything from Washington, D.C. that gets in the way of our self-determination. The only thing that's happened in Washington is we now have permission to determine for ourselves what should happen far offshore.
Thank you. We'll go back to Congressman Woodall. What is your position on the alleged Russian interference with the 2016 election? And do you support the continuation of the Mueller investigation?
But Julianne, I want to put those again in two completely different categories. I'm 100% opposed to Russian interference in our elections, the past one or the next one. This bill that we passed last week has money in for election integrity in a bipartisan, common sense way. It matters whether or not we can keep the Russians out of our system. It's not just Facebook posts we're talking about this cycle. It's getting into the voting machines where the count is being tabulated. That's completely different as a uniting issue than where the Mueller investigation has been going. Now, I support getting to the bottom so that folks don't have any questions at all about who did what to whom and when did they do it. It offends me the way the president has been maligned for what folks have shown absolutely no proof of whatsoever. We've had the best lawyers in the business trying to catch him on it, and they failed. We finished our investigation in the House. Julianne terminated it with no finding of wrongdoing, and it's coming time for Mr. Mueller to do the same.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel.
Well, I think it's strange in a world where we spend $700 billion a year on defense that Russians could actually hack our election system. Collusion, well, like they talk about, is not a crime in the first place, and so it should be dismissed, and Mueller should probably be terminated at the president's discretion. He is the boss, indeed. But when we flippantly use that type of money in offense and not defense, and we do a whole lot of meddling in places like the Middle East and other parts of the world, it should be no surprise to us, because our CIA, our State Department, our DIA, the NSA, and a whole bunch of other agencies with alphabet soup, they tend to meddle in these people's business, and so we should not be surprised when they try to meddle with ours. What we need to do is strengthen our cybersecurity first and foremost with that. The fact that we still have huge gaps in that, and I understand that because I still have a top secret clearance, that is one of the places we should be pouring that into, and we shouldn't be going off and spending a whole bunch of money overseas. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go back to you, Mr. Hazel. President Trump has imposed new tariffs of 25% on steel imports and import taxes of 10% on aluminum. Do you support targeted tariffs such as these?
I understand where the president's coming from. He is trying to level the playing field, so to speak. And as a businessman who knows construction and he understands how we are going to build our ships, I get where he's coming from. For a long time, the U.S. worker has been treated unfairly by the likes of NAFTA. What's great about what President Trump has done is he's walked away from deals like TPP that have saved us billions. He's walked away from the Paris Accords, which had no teeth whatsoever to speak of. And what we need to do is start to work to remove government so that we get free trade a chance, where people can trade through consent, where they improve the human condition, prices obviously come down, and the products and services go up at that point.
Congressman Woodall.
Hey, Julianne, what I have found fascinating about this president, you all must have seen it too over the last 13 months, is the way he gets everybody ginned up with the first words that comes out of his mouth. And everybody begins to panic, and suddenly the negotiating table begins to fill up with people, and suddenly people's hard and fast positions begin to melt a little bit, and suddenly we end up in a much better place than we were when we started. I've been fascinated by it on the world stage, and we've seen it time and time again. The president started out by saying it's going to be a tariff across the board. Then he said, no, we're going to exempt NAFTA countries because we have agreements with them, so we're going to exempt them. Then he said, no, we're going to exempt folks that we negotiate deals one country at a time with. We'll exempt them. And then we started seeing countries show up one at a time to try to make their deal better. I'm a free trader. But free trade has to also be fair trade. And the only way to get fair trade out of somebody who doesn't want to provide it is to negotiate for it. I applaud the president for what he's doing and the steps that he has made to make that possible.
Thank you. Congressman Whittle, what should Congress do to ensure they maintain integrity within the U.S. intelligence agencies?
You know, oversight over the intelligence agencies is one of the hardest things that we do. If you've been to the Capitol, you've been through the Capitol Visitor Center, the Intelligence Committee is three floors underground there behind a two-foot steel door. Doing oversight over the Intelligence Committee for rank-and-file members of Congress is incredibly difficult to do. The most important thing we have to do is make sure we have an Intelligence Committee chairman that we can trust and have confidence in. And I'll tell you, Devin Nunes has done that for me. If you've been following Devin and the way he's worked that committee, he's been doing an amazing job. For me, as your congressman, with your voting card, that means I'm going out to NSA to visit with folks one-on-one. It means I'm going into CIA stations to visit with folks one-on-one. There's a very tight communication between what they call the Big Four on the intelligence committees for the largest of the programs. I get to go out and visit with the rank and file members of these agencies one-on-one, get the real story from men and women who know, and it matters.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Once upon a time, when people sat before Congress and testified, we actually saw results. We saw justice. With Jeff Sessions at the helm, we have not seen that. We need oversight into our intelligence agencies that's real and it's accountable. Because if nobody pays and the Congress just investigates itself and investigates the government, back in history, I believe King Henry did the same thing when he shot his brother in the face with an arrow. Don't worry about it, people, we'll investigate ourselves. There has to be justice. What we have seen right now throughout Congress, they'll question them all day long, and people who will commit perjury on the stand will walk free. People that target you through the IRS and everything else out there as conservatives walk free. Nobody pays, and I'm afraid that Congress, the larger body, part of the establishment, is to blame for it.
Congressman Whittle, I'm going to allow a rebuttal.
Thank you, Julianne. This is what we do as Republicans. If anybody has any questions about Jeff Sessions' integrity, I want you to come and see me. Or visit any number of your folks who know him at a personal level in Alabama or in the United States Senate. His integrity is beyond reproach. And for us to decide that we finally have a president in the White House who agrees with us, we finally have a cabinet that agrees with us, and the first time things don't go our way, we're going to start throwing out cabinet members because they didn't agree with us, that's not the way to build the nation that you and I both want to build. Jeff Sessions is doing the best he can with the hand that he has been dealt. Whether you want to take it from me, whether you want to take it from Trey Gowdy, whether you want to take it from President Trump, we're doing the best we can to bring to light things that are incredibly sensitive, and rather than rushing to judgment, you're seeing things brought together one line item at a time, exactly the way you and I would want them to do, and I hope it makes you proud.
Mr. Hayes, what is the most serious issue facing American healthcare, and how would you fix it?
Most serious issue facing American healthcare. Well, it's probably the same thing that's facing our time. It's a government crisis. Wherever the government interjects itself, we see more cost and less service. Being a veteran, I see it firsthand. Veterans, we are pandered to left and right by people like Mr. Woodall, who send out flyers paid with your tax money about veterans, when in fact, the VA can't be saved. We are the product of a single-payer system where we wait in line, we receive terrible service when we get there, and sometimes they just throw pills at us. What we need to do is get government out of healthcare, period, once and for all, and let states choose for themselves. If California wants to be single-payer, by all means, but the rest of us need a free market, and then Congress needs to free us up. On top of that, the spending. What we spend and what they'll tell you we spend in Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid is completely out of line with what they've told us for the past 8 years.
Thank you. Mr. Whittle.
The Julianne, you can read any of the actuaries' reports if you want the numbers. There's no serious person who would tell you that those actuarial reports have been pushed one way or the other by any party in particular. It's just the math and the accounting, and there's some frightening numbers in there. I would encourage you to read that. The challenge we have with where the federal government is involved in health care, and even in third-party payer systems in private ways, is folks don't have skin in the game any longer. If you don't have skin in the game as a consumer, you can't control anything. Imagine going to Walmart if there were no prices on anything to try to figure out your grocery list. Would you make different decisions than you do today? Of course you would. The question is, how can we get more consumer participation? And anybody who wants a single-payer plan, it's easy to do. We can always pass that law. Breathing life back into a competitive healthcare system, a free market system, that's a once-in-a-generation opportunity. And we need all hands on deck to make sure we get that done.
Mr. Hazel, I'm going to allow a rebuttal.
Yeah, the fact that we still have Obamacare on the books with Republicans at the helm after 8 years, no proper prior planning, as we used to say in the Marine Corps, that prevents piss poor performance where I come from. The fact that we don't have a plan, the fact that we still have Obamacare, the fact that they changed the narrative from full repeal and they took 72 show votes, and when it was time to actually go out and play ball, they offered up what? The individual mandate? It's absurd. It's an affront to the American people. Mr. Woodall has been part of that, and it's got to stop. I'm telling you right now, I will never spend money, and I will never vote outside the Constitution. That is not a constitutionally delegated authority of the Congress to do anything with health care. It is a power reserved to the people and the states. Thank you.
Mr. Woodall, can the federal budget be balanced without raising taxes, and if so, how?
The federal budget cannot be balanced if we refuse to deal with revenues ever. We'll have a chance to talk about this when the Highway Trust Fund gets reauthorized. The Highway Trust Fund is a user fee-based system. If we don't want more roads, we don't need more roads. If we want more roads, we should be willing to pay for more roads. The most dangerous thing happening in conservative politics today is folks who are telling us that we can get a free lunch. We cannot. This was not a $1.5 trillion tax cut. It was a $1.5 trillion tax cut today that we're all going to have to pay back in the future. Now, it's going to be good. The economy is going to be higher. Things are going to be better. It was good economics. But it is irresponsible of us to send folks to Congress or any level of government where the message is, I want more stuff, but I'm not the one who's willing to pay for it. Tax him. We're either in it together or we're not. And this is as good an example of fiscal stewardship in this county as we have anywhere in the country.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Good stewardship starts with spending our money wisely, not spending it in 17 hours, 2,000 plus pages, and $1.3 trillion, who my opponent voted for. We have a money issue in this country, and it's time we audit the Fed. We had, in turn of the century, in 1900, 5 silver quarters made out of silver. That was $1.25, and that was minimum wage. Today, those 5 real silver quarters that don't exist anymore, those are worth $15 an hour. What we could do is audit the Fed and the Federal Transparency Act of 2017, I would sign on to immediately. My opponent has not. There are over 100 representatives that have. Let that sink in for a second. We are the party of limited government and responsibility, period. And when we vote otherwise, we're not Republicans. When we vote for omnibus bill after omnibus bill and appropriations bill with no accountability, we've got to send a message to D.C.
Thank you, Mr. Woodall. A rebuttal?
Julianne, the reason he sees the world through that lens is because he's not in the thick of it. This process didn't start last week. The House passed all the appropriations bills line by line by line last September. We've been working on this for 6 months to get today. Omnibus bills are not the right way to do business, and Senator Perdue and I have been placed on a 16-member committee to solve that. I'm excited about what we're going to be able to do. But lest folks forget, it was an omnibus bill that we passed that protected Forsyth and Gwinnett County's water from Alabama just 2 years ago. The omnibus bill is just another word for we did it all at one time putting together those individual things we've done along the way. The Senate process is broken. Please don't ask me to defend that. But it is voting no on everything that I would tell you cost us the opportunity to repeal Obamacare and cost us the opportunity for the largest mandatory spending reform in history, and I hope we'll get a chance to talk about that.
Thank you. Mr.
Hayes? I need a rebuttal, correct?
Well, usually it's just a rebuttal if you invoke the other person.
He did. He said, I'm not in the thick
of it. Go ahead.
Correct?
Sure.
Go ahead. Great. 79 to $70.9 billion to take over the education system centrally, central planning for Common Core. $51 million in international family planning and reproductive health, $10 million for environmental UN programs, $20 million in Middle East scholarships, $50 million for Planned Parenthood. Unbelievable to sit here and have the gall to tell all these people it's sunshine and rainbows, and then it's been going on since last September. 17, you can see it boils my blood. It is one of those things where they spend our kids' futures into oblivion and they don't blink about telling you how good it is. I mean, you're not a Jedi. You're not going to sit here and say these aren't the appropriations and funding you're looking for. It's absolutely insane. Ladies and gentlemen, I will never ever spend one red cent on Planned Parenthood, period, along with all the other unconstitutional programs that are up there. I've signed and reject the debt. And I'm told I need to stop now, so I will, but keep going.
Okay, thank you. So back to Mr. Hazel. Do you believe that congressmen should have term limits? And if so, why? And if not, why not?
I've already invoked and self-imposed 8 years on myself. I will be leaving and coming back to spend time with my family. This is not something that I think that I ever even imagined doing. And it's going to take a heck of a lot more time away from my prized possession, which is my family. Yes, I will be coming home. I will encourage others to self-impose term limits, and we will lead by example not only there, but we will not take the congressional pension, and we will not take the congressional health care, unlike my opponent. Because when you do that, what you're doing is saying, we have a political class that's not the same as your average citizen. That's also got to stop. We all live in America, and equal justice for all was one of those things that we used to say in school every morning. I will work to fight for term limits across the board, and I will do it by leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. Congressman Whittle?
Juliana, my constitution tells me we already have term limits. They're called elections. They happen every 2 years, and if elections are broken, let's fix elections. But I don't think we need a constitutional amendment to tell me that I can't send back to the United States Senate a senator that I'm proud of. So I reject the notion that self-governance is broken and elections are broken in a way that require a constitutional amendment to fix it. I don't know where to begin, Julianne, with the misinformation gets put out, but I want to share it with you all. If you elect a new congressman to this district, he's going to get the exact same pension that the guy who mows the lawn at the U.S. Department of Agriculture gets in downtown Atlanta. If you elect a new congressman to this district, he's not going to get the health care plan that gardener gets. The gardener's going to get a better plan. He's going to go on Obamacare because that's the only plan that's available to the United States Congress. Please don't buy into the same things that my mother buys into from time to time and emails me about. Rob, I raised you better than that. These things are not true, and repeating them only undermines our conservative cause.
Mr. Hazel?
Yeah, so at a meeting, you look it up on YouTube, he said, I take it because it's free. You can't expect people not to take things that are free. So yeah, it's a little different in misinformation. All right, more sunshine and rainbows, people. It is incumbent upon us to live our lives in line with you. And that is, I don't know how else to say it. It is absolutely repugnant to sit there and say, they don't. They obviously do. There's a Walter Reed Center on the top floor that takes care of everybody. The bottom floors are reserved for veterans, and they definitely receive much better care. And Obamacare is not what I'm going to be going after. I'm going to go out to the same marketplace that you guys have to deal with.
Okay, Mr. Whittle?
We can exist in the world of reality or we cannot. And I will tell you that I want you to think back to a year ago today, a year ago in March. We were on the verge of passing the repeal of Obamacare. We were on the verge of passing the largest mandatory spending change in the history of this country in block granting Medicaid. And vote no conservatives decided it wasn't good enough, and they balked. It took us 2.5 months to get it done. We finally did get it done. How many votes did that bill fail by in the United States Senate? One. You tell me, if instead of kicking the president in the shins on our primary agenda, first out of the gate, we'd come together and said, no, it's not perfect, but it's better than doing nothing, I'm in, would it have been worth one more vote in the United States Senate? You know what momentum does in politics. That's what keeps me up at night. Not the ridiculous narratives that that come from folks who aren't studying the material, but the truth that we had a chance to make a difference. And we let perfection keep us from it.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall, are there any federal departments you would support consolidating or eliminating?
I wouldn't start with the VA. I've made too many promises to veterans. The country has made too many promises to veterans, and it's a generational issue. My younger veterans would rather use the Veterans Choice Program that we created and opt out of the VA. But many of my older veterans say, Rob, the VA is the only group that understands me. Now, I want them to work better, I want them to be more efficient, but they're the only folks who understand me. Mm-hmm. There's not a federal department that we have that we've got to keep. There's not a one that we've got to keep. We can turn the Pentagon into a triangle. America will live to fight another day. The question is, how are we achieving those goals? The Department of Agriculture, led by our former Governor Perdue, is running better today than it was 14 months ago. I've reduced fewer departments of the parts of the Department of Agriculture today because of who is there in control. I think we've got to use all the levers we have while we have a president who's willing to use them wisely and continue the attrition of federal government employees as President Trump has made part of our collective mission.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
Yeah, absolutely. I would abolish the VA because I'm a veteran. I've been in the system. I know how it works. I speak to veterans all the time and know how it works. You abolish the VA, you give every veteran an Amex card, and the DOD picks up the cost of war, which are veterans, because we're all different. Some of us are going to handle PTSD differently. Some of us are going to handle our wounds differently, and we need the choice to go where we want, because right now, when we walk in there, we're told after a couple months you have an appointment, maybe you can come in. We don't have the technology to upload anything that you have in terms of, you know, images and anything else. And then after taking some blood work, maybe you had some Chick-fil-A beforehand, your blood looks like gravy. Instead of actually having a conversation with you about your diet, they'll throw opioids and cholesterol medicine at you before you even know what happened. It's absolutely ridiculous and absurd. I'd cut the VA, I'd cut the Department of Education, I would cut the IRS. Abolish the IRS and stop state-sponsored terrorism right now because it's targeted groups like you. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel, what would your top legislative priorities be in the next Congress?
Ladies and gentlemen, it's no secret that veterans, service members are nearest and dearest to me. Article 1, Section 8 gave us the power of war in Congress. We have not declared war since World War II, and yet we spend almost $1 trillion on it every year without mission. And this is what broke my back to get into this race, because when I called Congressman Woodall's office, couple years ago, and I said, you guys just spent $700 billion. What's the mission? That's exactly what I heard. Taking the lives of our men and women flippantly and sending them overseas into countries where we have not declared war, putting boots on the ground, destroying families, souls, lives. Those are my brothers that have got 10 plus deployments down line. That is unforgivable. And the fact that the Congress hasn't stood up and made a peep but continues to fund it because we have to have defense as a lie. We have been on offense. What we should do is pull our men and women back. We should pull them into a security posture and increase technology and defense here at home, not abroad.
Thank you. Mr. Woodall.
Julianne, those deployment decisions, as everyone in this room knows, fall under Article 2, not Article 1. It is absolutely true that we have not worked together as a nation to make sure that everybody has the same amount of skin in the game. And when you talk about what the revenue components of a future a bill could be, I think we've got to talk about how it is we fund that overseas mission. If you don't have a son or a daughter, a mom or a dad involved in the war effort today, it's not at the top of your list. It's certainly not on the front page of the paper. It's not anywhere to be found in Section A. And if we don't have skin in the game, just like in healthcare we make bad decisions, in foreign affairs we make bad decisions too. But I've got a brand new president on a very dangerous world stage, and careless talk in the middle of a debate is a freebie. But undermining the president in front of America's enemies is not, and I'm not going to be a part of it.
Mr. Hazel, a rebuttal?
Yeah, I'll rebut, and I'll stand up to the president too. Because what we should be talking about is peace. Peace was a virtue and a principle that our framers held dear, and we have been in battle for 17 plus years, and not a peep out of this office or a ton of other offices up there in D.C. It is time to stand up and fight. We can't just go along to get along. Yes, is North Korea an irrational actor? Sure. Is Iran an irrational actor? But guess what? Where goods and services cross boundaries, armies and tanks don't. And the people that pay are the grunts and the special forces, my brothers. That's got to change. Because it's not on the headline news anymore, don't forget about it, because they haven't forgot about it. And when they say they won't make the fight, I believe them. He won't make the fight. He won't have that discussion. I'm not going up there to make friends, people. I am going up there on a mission to restore the Constitution and this republic.
Thank you. Mr. Whittle, would you like to rebut?
I would, Julianne. If you elect Shane King for a day, he can do everything that he's promised you. The Constitution will be out the window, but he could do it. We vote time and time again to control U.S. foreign policy, and we don't have the votes to win. Folks, we have a Republican majority. We don't have a conservative majority on Capitol Hill. And to decide that folks are going to do nothing because they can only do a little is a mistake, a fatal mistake. We have an opportunity with this White House to work together. I'm not surrendering my oversight responsibilities of the White House, and you can see that in the investigations going on Capitol Hill. But on the international stage, where the Congress does not have a large constitutional role, I tell you that I didn't want to go out and undermine my president when he was a Democrat, and I most certainly don't want to undermine my president with our enemies when he is a Republican. We are Americans first, and foreign affairs is the place we show that to the world.
Thank you. Mr. Whittle, what will you do in the next Congress to address illegal immigration?
I wouldn't wait till the next Congress, Julianne. I think we can do it right now, and candidly, we can do this in partnership together. Folks have forgotten how to say yes. It's all fight, 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 fight. You're wrong, I'm right. Folks have forgotten how to take yes for an answer. The president offered Dreamers an answer. He said, listen, all I want to do is make sure another generation doesn't get trapped in this same space. So let's focus on border security. And I want to make sure that we have an immigration policy that promotes employment. So let's focus on skills-based immigration. And laws are laws, so we do need interior enforcement. But beyond that, let's put this behind us forever. I now have Dreamers coming into my office saying, Rob, I need you to support the Trump immigration plan. What we can't do is let the left off for saying we don't have a plan and that we have an opportunity. They want this as a political issue instead of a way to move the country forward. You can't move immigration reform forward without doing border security, because you just trap another family in that same space tomorrow. But the president has offered a negotiated bargain. Wouldn't have been the one I proposed, but I support him and I believe we can get it done this year.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
So when you guys say you support him, does that mean you spend $1.3 trillion and there's very little set aside for a border wall? We still fund sanctuary cities that are out in California? Because that's what we just did. $1.3 trillion we're still spending out in California and giving grants and everything else, and we have no border security. You can do a couple things. Shut off the welfare magnet, period. No illegals get welfare from the United States. That'll start pushing them back right there. We can bring our troops home, secure the southern border real quick, and we can give them all a raise so that they can compete with those wages out there on the free market. There's a real easy fix to our border security. Turn off the welfare, secure the border with our veterans and our military, and let it be gone. We've just gone ridiculous, I guess, in passing an omnibus bill with all this in it. We spent, 17 hours is what you guys passed it in. 17 hours, 2,000 pages, at one page per minute, it would take 37 hours to read it. And that's what they did.
Thank you, Mr. Will.
Julianne, as anybody who's read the bill knows, there are more miles of wall in that omnibus bill than President Trump asked for this year. We plussed that up. We plussed up the number of detention beds in that bill. And President Trump, as you saw if you follow his Twitter feed, almost vetoed the bill because he wanted to solve the DACA issue in this bill too. And the Democrats said no, they wouldn't sign off on it because they wanted to keep it as a political issue. They don't believe the nonsense that immigration is only a net negative. I'm going to tell you, this has always been a country that has attracted people because of freedom and opportunity. It's not welfare that brings most people here. It's the desire to build a better life for their family through hard work. I'm just going to tell you, be flippant if you would like. I represent in this district, and Shane would too, 27% of this district is first-generation American families, legal. And they came here because they believe in what we believe in, faith, family, freedom, education, opportunity. I don't denigrate them. I applaud them. I'm glad they're here.
Illegal immigration. You want to play with words, that's fine. They all know it. They laughed. I mean, good. Thank you. I mean, it is. It's laughable at this point. It's laughable when they come down here and they tell us, oh, everything's great. Here's some good news. Let me pull out my prop constitution because I'm not going to abide by it. Things like privacy that is not in your constitution either. Listen, there are real fixes. There's a real fight that needs to happen. I'm telling you, on this stage, I'm pretty sure most of you understand who's going to make the fight.
Thank you. So, Mr. Whittle, infrastructure is one of the major responsibilities of government. In a growing and fast-paced economy like Metro Atlanta, our infrastructure has had a very difficult time keeping up with growth. On March 14th, President Trump sent five cabinet secretaries to go before the Senate Committee on Commerce. Commerce, Science, and Transportation, for the purpose of gaining bipartisan support for the President's $1.5 trillion infrastructure plan to repair roads, bridges, ports, and airports. Many doubt it will ever see a vote. Do you support this plan? And can you explain how it will benefit Georgia and work in cooperation with states? And how can it be paid for?
We're in the best place to benefit, Julianne, because we have a track record of success and stewardship. Whether you talk about Forsyth County and the bonding initiative out on 400 that was 12 months from a vote to groundbreaking and 12 months from groundbreaking to opening up a lane, or whether you talk about the work that went on down the 85 bridge rebuild. The entire nation was watching that effort, and Georgia developed a reputation for being serious about being a stewardship of those funds. So anything that provides more infrastructure funding at the federal level, Julianne, we will be the beneficiaries of here in Georgia. But don't give us not enough credit for what we've been doing to fund ourselves here in Georgia. And that's the real challenge in President Trump's plan. A lot of folks want to take that money and spend it on states that have done nothing to help themselves, folks who are in so-called crisis spaces. Georgia raised its taxes $1 billion a year so we could begin to move forward ourselves. We front-loaded all the Savannah Port funding, paying for it ourselves, so we'd be ready when the federal money came. Biggest job that I have is making sure it goes to folks who have been good stewards, not those who have frittered their opportunities away.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
What our job is to keep Article 6, Section 3, our oath of office, in check, and that is to the Constitution and the Constitution only. There is no space in there for most of the things that they spend money on. Think about this. Our government pulls in a little over $3.5 trillion a year. You divide that by 435 congressmen up there, that is $9 billion a piece that they're told to spend responsibly. That is the farce that is our federal government. In terms of our roads and our infrastructure, Mr. Woodall sits on the committee. Where is it at? We have bridges collapsing. We have no accountability still from the U.S. Congress, and it'll continue and continue. But to spend each one of them $9 billion a piece, that is like telling a Mark Zuckerberg, go out and spend your entire life fortune and do it responsibly. That was why the founders wanted the money left in the states in the first place. What we need to do is abolish the IRS, which we didn't hear a word about during the last tax overhaul from apparently the champion.
Mr. Riddle.
Julie, I stuck to know where to begin. Those math numbers aren't anywhere close to right. Georgia's entire take from the FAST Act, which is our transportation funding bill, was about $6 billion. And I'll tell you, if you want good stewardship, we've got a room full of conservatives here. We gave the private sector a giant bonus when they finished the I-85 rebuild on time or ahead of time and under budget.
Why?
Anybody mad about that big bonus that those guys got? Anybody think that that's a problem? Folks, we incentivized good behavior and we got good behavior. And we're now a model for the rest of the country. I'm not at all surprised about some of the shenanigans that went on in the Obama Transportation Department, but Secretary Chao is second to none in terms of being a talented leader. She's spending more time in Georgia than almost any other state in the nation. And we can do woe is me if we'd like, but our opportunity is now to make a difference. We have, and we will continue to. I'm optimistic about tomorrow, Julianne.
Yes, what would you like to rebut?
When you continue to spend the way they do, erratically, irresponsibly, negligently, you're going to continue to get the same thing over and over and over. It's all sunshine and rainbows here. Don't worry about it. Nothing to see. Move along, citizen. The $3.5 trillion, if we're listening, is what the U.S. government pulls in every year. With $3.5 trillion, and we spend probably about $4 trillion of that, because let's not let our kids have a future. Let's put them in debt. That money can pave the roads in Georgia and every other state in the nation multiple times over, but it's squandered for special interests so that they don't make people mad through omnibus bills and appropriations bills so they come back to their district and get reelected and start the whole vicious cycle over and over again.
Mr. Hazel, what would your plans be to stop the federal government from continuing to encroach upon states' rights?
Make a fight. For God's sakes, nullification, standing up, education, it takes a backbone. It doesn't take an act of Congress. We need to teach locally. That's why I teach the Constitution here. That's why I teach it to groups so that they can empower their own legislatures, their own citizens, their own councilmen, so that they can stand up. Because when's the last time we had a governor that sat there and said, no, federal government, you will not come in the state? The Attorney General, the Secretary of State, when is the last time they push back? They have a small and defined box that they're supposed to be in. And then our governor, our citizens here, we should be holding them accountable. That's what we should be doing to push them back. They're not gonna ever limit themselves. Governments just don't do that. Governments grow overnight and they will take as much lead as you'll give them. What we have to do is cut them off, and that's going to take somebody who's going to go up there and fight them. It's not going to be somebody that approves omnibus bills and appropriations bills every time they come across their desk, and then, on top of that, raise the debt ceiling so that we can keep doing it.
Thank you, Mr. Riddle.
Julianne, I confess I've forgotten what the question was.
What will you do to stop the federal government's continued encroachment upon states' rights?
You can say that no one puts up a fight and states never push back and we just roll over, but that's not giving the citizens of Georgia enough credit. That Obamacare plan was on its way to nationalizing every ounce of health care we have in this country, and citizens like those of us in Georgia stood up and said no, and the governor sued and the attorney general sued, and we won. The underpinning of Obamacare was putting everybody on the expanded Medicaid program. States like Georgia said no, and we stopped it. The most challenging thing I have in terms of states' rights are that folks like them sometimes, they don't like them others. I have the lowest NRA score of any Republican in the state of Georgia, because the NRA said, I want to nationalize some gun laws. And I said, no, my reading of the Constitution tells me that's a state-by-state issue. You don't get to encroach in that way. I voted no. Cost me on a scorecard, doesn't matter on a scorecard. I'm going to do what I think is right on our behalf. But I got phone calls from so many states' rights folks here who said, Rob, well, in this case, maybe the Second Amendment should trump the Tenth Amendment. I say no.
So on Obamacare, we won, huh? Is that what you're telling me? Because I'll tell you right now, I have a single-income family, and I went from probably paying about $4,000 to $5,000 a year to now we're up to about $20,000 a year for health care. We didn't win as a population. It's the Georgia 7th District, I can tell you, is in the same boat I am because I talk to my neighbors. We are definitely not winning on health care, especially when they told us they were going to repeal it and not replace it. Let the free market work. Repeal it already, for God's sakes. I mean, these broken promises, this 2018 is going to be a heck of a year, people, because not only the primaries going on, but then we have the midterms, and the Republicans, because of voting like this, are going to get shellacked.
Well, Julianne, I'm not looking for the vote no all the time vote. I'm willing to concede I'm probably not going to win Shane's vote here tonight. But what I am going to do is be proud about the work I've done with your voting card for 7 years, and I'm going to go back and I'm going to do it again for the next 9 months, and if you give me the honor, I'll do it again for another 2 years. I can tell you, and it will break your heart, line item after line item after line item that we could have gotten done, but we failed because the perfectionist caucus said no. If you want to be right, go be a college professor. If you want to get something done, come to the United States Congress. To denigrate what Governor Deal did and our Attorney General did in pushing back on Medicaid expansion is to fail to acknowledge the biggest success in states' rights that we've had in the last 2 decades. If it's not good enough, fair enough. But don't deny its existence. It was a step in the right direction, and we should keep pushing, not throw folks under the bus who made the fight.
Thank you. This will be our final general question for both candidates. I think we're doing very well on time. We managed to get through all the questions. Recently, we have seen more left-leaning textbooks, especially in AP classes, in our public schools as a result of federally pushed Common Core. How have you used or will you use your office to bring more local control to our school systems in the Southern District?
Well, two answers to that right off the bat, Julianne. Number one, we repealed No Child Left Behind. We were opposed on that repeal effort by folks who said it didn't do enough. Wall Street Journal called it the largest return of power and local control to local school systems in the history of the country. But for some people, it wasn't enough. I voted yes because I wanted to make that positive step in the right direction. I know folks are still concerned about Common Core. The law of the land as we sit here today is the federal government can neither punish nor incentivize anyone, anywhere, to adopt Common Core. That's a change in the law. We pushed it. We won. It's the law of the land as we sit here today. I know there are a lot of school systems that are failing, and they worry that they need federal help. I represent an area where school systems are second to none, and I worry the federal government's going to come in and mess up what we've spent so many local hours, so many families, so many teachers, so many administrators trying to build. We'll keep pushing back on that, Julianne, but we've made great progress in the last 4 years.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
I wish his rhetoric matched his voting record, because $70.9 billion was spent in the omnibus for the Department of Education. My wife's a teacher. I understand very well the disaster, which is Common Core and federal government overreach, which is not sanctioned through our Constitution. It's not a power. When it came through with Jimmy Carter, it started to grow. It started to centralize power of the federal government in education. And what do we have now? Common Core, even though maybe they repealed it. He voted on S-1177, where every student succeeds, mandatory testing. It's just another word for Common Core, people. He's funded it over and over and over to the tune of billions of dollars. And then H.R. 899, where Thomas Massie put it forward to the Congress, abolished the Department of Education with one subject, one page, and Mr. Woodall did not sign on to that. I'll tell you right now, funding the Department of Education at the national level is a travesty. We have lower test scores now. We have a worse product in reading and writing, you name it. We've got to stop it.
Julianne, he's invoked Thomas Massie's name twice. I wish Thomas was here to tell you who it is he thinks is a champion for conservative ideals on Capitol Hill, and I promise you he would be sitting right here beside me, because we've worked together time and time again to make a difference. The Every Student Succeeds Act that he belittles is the one that repealed No Child Left Behind. Now, you can have your pick. You can keep No Child Left Behind if you'd like, or you can pass Every Student Succeeds. I choose repeal and pass. What he cites as mandatory testing language that's the same as Common Core is actually a specific repeal of federal mandates of mandatory testing that allows individual jurisdictions to decide for themselves how to evaluate the success of their students. That was one of the bills we used the Congressional Review Act to repeal from the Obama administration regulatory agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Hazel.
It's all sunshine and rainbows still. Meanwhile, test scores have gone down in our general population. Reading has gone down. Writing has gone down. The use of cursive. The understanding of civics has gone down, and the understanding of our constitutional republic has obviously hit almost rock bottom. When we sit there and say, well, we're not going to fund this, it's not because we don't love kids and we don't love teachers. In fact, the opposite is true. This whole one-size-fits-all for every school district across this nation, we need to be fostering small business entrepreneurial spirit. That's not what we talk about. We talk about the track to college. You've got to go to college so you can get a career, so you can give the government all your money, so they can spend it on ludicrous things like quail being more sexually promiscuous on coke. It's ridiculous. That's what this Bahamas dust does. It's insane. To say we need more of it, I don't know what to do with the people. What I do know, it is not a constitutionally delegated authority of the federal government, and therefore, per my oath, I will not be voting for it.
Thank you. At this time, we're going to move on to the next portion, where each candidate will be asking a question of the opposing candidate. So we will begin with Mr. Hazel. Please ask your question of your choice to Congressman Woodall.
Sure. Congressman Woodall, you rate an F from Conservative Review, The New American. You got a D from Heritage, which will probably drop to an F after they factor in the omnibus bill. Why don't you just run as the Democrat?
I appreciate that question, Shane. Does anybody ever look at that?
I did.
Anybody look
Stop
at that?
Stop it. Hold it. Rob, I've had enough of it.
We're going to remain civil. We're going to remain civil. We're going to remain civil. The congressman doesn't mind answering this question, and we're going to remain civil in this audience, please.
If there's any confusion in this audience about whether I'm surrendering your voting card to any scoring organization on Capitol Hill, the answer is no, I am not. It belongs to you. Conservative Review will tell you, if you go and look at their scorecard, that Elizabeth Warren and a guy named Johnny Isaacson are about the same degree of conservatism. Do you buy that? Do you believe that Conservative Review would tell you that Kamala Harris, likely a Democratic nominee for the presidency, is twice the conservative that Johnny Isaacson is?
Yeah, I'm right. Yeah.
We just have a different idea of what it means to be a public servant. Folks want 100% or they say vote no. I'm calling 80% a victory, and score me an F all day long, every day. David Perdue's got a D. Who believes that? Folks, we define conservatism, not some for-profit magazine, and it's going to stay that way as long as I have your voting card.
Okay. Would you like to rebut any of those?
Sure.
Okay. Mr. Woodall?
Julianne, I didn't have this question, but having listened tonight, I understand everything that Shane's going to vote no against, and he's upset that I voted yes. My question is there anything that I voted no on, and if only you were there, you'd have made it happen?
Is there anything you voted no on that I'd make happen?
Yeah.
Specifically?
You disagree with all of my yes votes. I'm just wondering if you disagree with my no votes as well.
You've done a few things well. I believe when you give people the choice to go and choose their medication in terms of the state's rights and giving families choices, where they have kids with epilepsy, cancer, things like that, I think that's actually a pretty good vote. Outside of that, yeah, I absolutely disagree with most of your voting record.
To be fair, I wasn't asking what you appreciated about my voting record, though I am grateful for that. What I was saying is, clearly you don't like the fact that I support so many items in the president's agenda. I'm looking for something that I opposed that you said, you know what, I finally do think that's a good idea.
Yep.
We should have gotten
every done. Time you support the United States Constitution, per your oath, I agree with you. And that is what we should be looking for. Our congressmen and women who vote with the Constitution. It's not even partisan. It's just a document that kept our government on track and out of our lives. Whenever he votes yes with that, I'm absolutely fine with that, Congressman. I am, and I pray that you do it more and more often and you start to set a trend, because what we see now is absolutely insanity, and it's not sunshine and rainbows. We've got to make a correction. We've got to have somebody there that's going to make that fight for the entire 100%, not just 80.
And Mr. Woodall, I will ask you what I asked Mr. Hazel. Would you like to rebut?
No, thank you, Julie.
All right. Thank you. At this time, we'll move into closing statements, and we'll begin with Mr. Woodall.
Well, I got to begin with you, and now I'm getting to end with you. I appreciate you coming out tonight. I'm proud of what we've done together for 7 years. I'm thrilled about this campaign that we're going to have. We get to choose who we are as Republicans. Day in and day out, we show up together, and we're able to make a difference. We're able to make a difference when it comes to tax reform, and that bill is different and better because you and I are involved. We're able to make a difference when it comes to spending, and yes, we are spending less because you and I are involved. We're able to make a difference with our neighbors. It's been over 1,300 pieces of casework we've had a chance to work on together for our neighbors who are grappling with the federal government. Just this cycle, 50,000 pieces of correspondence that we've traded back and forth as we've worked to try to make things better. But folks, I'll tell you, this is just the sideshow for all Republicans across the country this primary season. The fight comes in November. And if you tell me that we're going to run on how angry we are, instead of the lowest unemployment in 50 years, the highest business optimism in two decades, the lowest number of layoffs in 50 years, the highest rate of school completion education that we've seen, folks, we are getting it done together. This fight is going to be over folks who aren't sure whether America should look more like Elizabeth Warren or Donald Trump. We've got a chance to tell our story of success as we have experienced it here locally and as we've delivered it in Washington, D.C. I'm asking you for your support and for your vote, and I thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Hazel.
Thank you again, everybody, for coming out and listening to this. I really do appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, the arbitrary federal government that we have now is a crisis of our time. I believe the constitutional government is the fix, and you've got to have a fighter for that. I swore that oath to uphold the Constitution, and that means more now than it ever has. We have got to get back to some sanity and lead by example. That's why I'm leaving after 8 years no matter what. That's why I will not be taking the health care that's provided by our government at that level, and I will not be taking the pension plan either. I look forward to earning your vote May 22nd. I believe we need a principled, proven fighter in D.C., to represent the Georgia 7th District, which is my home. I appreciate you guys coming out. Thank you for the Republican Party for putting this on. I will see you guys around the Georgia 7th District and everywhere else I find you. Good night.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. We hope to see you on May 2nd. Thank you, Sarah.
I just love the two of you.